Pt.4.
Money, 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 must be funny in the rich man's world.
Well, good morning, Dream City Church. You're a bunch of good-looking people, and you're singing great today. Look at somebody and tell them you're the best-looking thing I've seen today. Come on. Yeah. Now look at your second choice and tell them. Hey, wasn't that an awesome video about keepers of the house? Come on. Wasn't that great? Come on, everybody. Hey, that is a fabulous ministry right here at Dream City Church that takes care of the grounds and the inside, prepares a place that's clean and excellent for us to build community and to worship God together. Hey, and there are some opportunities for you to be a part of that ministry and to serve and become a part of those who prepare the house of God for us together every week. If you'll just look at the QR code, if you'll take your phone out, you can hit the QR code. It'll bring you to a list of ministries, and you can just go down and find Keepers of the House, and they are ready for you. Click it, and someone will call you. Or you can go out to the Welcome Center, and Misty will be out at the Welcome Center after this service today. Be a great opportunity for you to get involved. And today, we have a special organization with us called Safe Families of Oklahoma. They are a volunteer organization that walks along, aids, and helps families that are in crisis. Parents and children who are at risk need someone like you and I to come along beside them, mentor them, and help them, coach them, and walk with them through their crisis when they're at risk. This is a great organization, and they have opportunities for you and I to get involved. You can become a part of that. If you'd like to learn more about it, ask some questions and find out how you can be involved. There will be a table in the Great Hall after service today. Go up to it, find out more about it, and see if you cannot get involved in that. And last but not least, thank you, everybody, for this past month opening your hearts, your homes, and taking good care of me and ministering to me. And you have provided for me well, and I am grateful. But this is my last Sunday. Our lead pastors, Mark and Erica Hennen, will be back in the house next Sunday. Come on, somebody. Yeah. And I know they'll be glad to see you, and you will be glad to see them. Well, this past Thursday, a week ago, I flew up to Denver, Colorado to see my son, my daughter-in-law, and my two grandsons. Hadn't seen them in over a year. Put that picture up, if you will. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful family? Now, I know it's hard for you to tell. I'm the one on your right. My son's the one on your left. But anyway, and my two grand boys, I know they look just like me. They're good looking. But I flew up there just to spend 3 or 4 hours with them. And as always, you know, I just am so proud of my son. He is a teaching pastor at a great multi-campus church there in the Denver area called Red Rocks Church. They're releasing great worship right now that's ministering to the body of Christ. So I just wanted to tell him how proud I was of him. And then I just took him out on the porch. I said, hey, son, want to talk to you about a couple of things. When you was growing up, you know, well, I didn't do so hot. And so I just want you to know it was my head and not my heart. I love you. I'm proud of you. And he looked at me and he said, Dad, I just want to tell you something. When I think about my childhood, I don't think about those things. And he said, I just want to remind you of what I posted this year. And so I want to just take a moment to share that with you. On my birthday, on March the 17th, put that post up if you will. My son posted this picture and he posted there, he said, happy birthday to the man who taught me how to pray, how to preach, how to lead. He said this, he said, probably not a day in my life when I woke up that I didn't wake up to the sound of my father walking and praying, to the smell of coffee, thank God, and to see his Bible laying on the table. And then on Father's Day of this year, put the next one up if you will, he posted this picture and said, happy Father's Day to the man who taught me to love this book, study this book, set my life on this book, let this book be the lighthouse of my life, and who believed that one day I would preach this book. Every day I stand on your shoulders, Pop, and everybody that sees me now gets to see what you believed in me when it was yet unseen. Yeah. Now, I'm not saying that to brag on me. Like I said, I did a lot of not so good things I always am having to apologize for. But I want you to notice that as my son talked to me, he never mentioned one time, man, Dad, I'm glad you bought that house at that address so I could grow up in that. He never talked to me about the name brand clothes that I clothed him in. He never once talked about the make and the model of cars that we drove. And never once mentioned the game boxes that I stood in line for every Black Friday for hours upon hours. Come on, somebody. You know what I'm talking about. Never mentioned any of that whatsoever. And I say that because I'm ending today a series that we've been doing on money matters on purpose. And if you've not seen it or you've missed one of the messages, I wish you'd go back on YouTube. You can find them there, Dream City OK, and you can watch those messages. I believe they'll be a blessing to you because really today I want to talk to you about what really matters. And I believe that today God wants to speak to us about why money matters when it comes to money. You see, I'm 64 years old, and I can promise you something, that there's coming a day when you're old or older, when you don't have to do what anybody tells you anymore, unless you're still married, then you do what your wife says. All the men should have said amen. And you're going to start looking back over your life and you're going to start thinking about, you know, what did my life mean? What did I really accomplish? What did I do with my life? Was it as important? Did it really matter? And I promise you the answer to that question is going to be important then. So if the answer to that question is going to be important then I believe the question itself should be important to us now. You see, we're talking about money, and we've talked about many things when it comes to money. And what the purpose of talking about money matters was, the stress, the debt, the weak paycheck to paycheck most people live, no money in savings to take care of emergencies, the stress, the anxiety, the worry, the depression, the arguments, the damage to relationships, the number one cause of divorce in our country. And we talked about all those things and how that Jesus in Matthew chapter 6 spoke into all of those issues in our life, and that God has a way for you and I. And I believe that Jesus looked at moments like this and he began to speak to us about living for the answer to that question that we're going to face one day. He kind of said it like this in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33 and verse 34. He said, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these things, he tells you what he's talking about. The clothes you wear, the food you eat, the house you live in, the car you drive, all the things that we worry and stress about. He said, they'll be given to you too. And then he says, so do not worry about tomorrow. Let tomorrow worry about itself. Living faithfully is a large enough task for today." Now notice this. Now he's been talking to us about worry, and now he says, don't worry about tomorrow. He says, what I want you to focus on is today. I want you to focus on seeking first the kingdom of God today. And when you go to bed tonight and get up in the morning, tomorrow will be today. And when you go to bed Monday night and get up Tuesday morning will be today. So he says, every day I just want you to take one day at a time. Live faithfully, seeking first the kingdom of God and trusting God to take care of you. That's what he was saying. Now, let me tell you what he was not saying. What he was not saying was, don't plan for the future. Don't save for the future. Don't invest into the future. He wasn't saying don't live your life for the future. He wasn't saying eat, drink, and be merry, and tomorrow we will die. He wasn't saying just be careless. In fact, that is probably the greatest challenge of our generation today, is most people just live for the moment. I mean, we live for whatever feels good at this moment, for the latest, greatest, fastest, newest, most bells and whistles, the 15, 16, or 21, whatever iPhone's coming out next. I mean, and you know, we like it now. We got drive-thrus, and we got Uber Eats to bring it to our house, and we got live stream, and we got on-demand, which means we decide and we can get it when we want it. And we've got Amazon Prime. Come on, everybody. Hallelujah. But with all of that, most of us live with no thought of tomorrow. And I know Jesus was saying this because before he said this and before he said don't worry, he spoke these words in the same chapter, chapter 6 of Matthew, verse 19 and verse 20. And he says, don't store up treasures here on earth where moths eat them and rust destroys them and where thieves break through and steal them. Now he's talking about the future. He's talking about your future. He says, store your treasures in heaven where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break and steal. Break in and steal. In other words, he says, I want you to live today, not worried about tomorrow, but living faithfully today for tomorrow. In fact, the Word of God says a lot about thinking about, planning for, saving for, and investing in your future. And not just when you get old or when you get older. Not just thinking about what your life meant and what kind of impact that you're going to have. But even about beyond this life. If you're a believer in Jesus and you're a child of God, then this life is not the end. In fact, God said it like this. He's speaking through one of his apostles that wrote 2/3 of the New Testament, the second half of the Bible. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he says this right here. He says, for we must all, everyone that knows God, will appear and be revealed as we are before the judgment seat of Christ. Christ is talking about Jesus, the Son of God, the Word of God, that left heaven, left all the beauty, all the splendor, all the comfort, all the glory of heaven, came and was born of a virgin and lived in a limited body and lived his life like you and I, except he lived his entire life surrendered to God for not himself, but for you and I. And one day, when our life ends as believers, we're going to stand before Jesus so that each one may receive his pay according to what he's done in this body. In other words, he's saying, I want you to think about the future. The real future is one day you're going to stand for me, and you are then going to be rewarded for what you did today. So live today. Don't worry about tomorrow. But live today planning for tomorrow. And then he says, whether good or evil. Those words in the original language that the Bible was written, the language of Greek, the word good really means of benefit, of value, and the word evil means worthless, no value, no benefit. In other words, when we stand before Jesus, our life is going to be rewarded according to whether we live for ourselves or we live for his kingdom. And then he says this, considering what his purpose and motives have been, what he has achieved, what he's been busy with, and given himself and his attention to accomplishing. In other words, I did a lot for my kids. I mean, you know, I wish they kind of knew what it was like buying them name brand clothes sometimes and standing in that line on. But all of those things are gone now. They're rusted, they're thrown away, they're given away, they don't work, the electronics are outdated, come on everybody, the cars are rusted. All that's gone. And what really matters are the things that are spiritual. Like asking yourself today, where am I going to be 10 years from now, 20 years from now? What kind of impact will I have made 30 years from now, 50 years from now? Okay, I achieved a lot, I had a lot, I did a lot, I owned a lot. But did it really matter? 50 years from now, will anybody even care the make and model you drove, the address you lived at, what kind of clothes you wear? Will anybody even remember? And then God says, now listen, I want you to focus on the future here. But I want you to live today, living in its fullness, but don't forget the future. Because God used this same apostle to say to us about that day we stand before Jesus, about the day we'll be rewarded as believers in Jesus. He says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. He says, but on the judgment day, fire will reveal what kind of work each builder has done. The fire will show if a person's work has any value. Is it worthless or of worth? Is it a benefit to others or is it valueless? If the work survives that fire, the builder will receive a reward. In other words, Jesus is saying that day's going to come and I want you to receive a reward. I want you to plan for that day. I want you to live today, not worried about that day, but living for that day. Not careless, but careful. But if the work is burned up, listen, everybody. Everybody look at me. Look at me. Look. He's not talking to sinners. This is not the great white throne judgment. This is us as believers. That we can make it to heaven because we're born again by the blood of Jesus, but yet have lived our life totally for ourselves, so that when we stand before him, there's no value into what we did with all of our life. And it's burned up. Now notice what he says. The builder will suffer great loss. Hey, this is in your Bible. It's been in your Bible before you ever owned a Bible. Been in this Bible since God wrote the Bible. And then look what it says. The builder will be saved, but like someone barely escaping through a... Do you understand what God is saying? He's saying, listen, you're going to make it. You're going to be in heaven. And somehow we would think that would be enough on its own. Come on. But yet he says, when you stand there that day, you could watch everything you live for in your life burn up and be of no benefit to anyone, rusted, outdated, thrown in the garbage and burned up because there was no eternal benefit to it whatsoever. Man. So Jesus is saying, I want you to live when it comes to money in your life. The whole chapter is about money. He says, when it comes to money in your life, I want you to live with your money for what really matters. And if we're going to do that, then I believe that Jesus and the Word of God can give you and I a way to do that. So that when we stand there that day, and maybe even before that day, I know I think about this a lot. In fact, I kind of try to make it a goal of mine. I don't get it right every day, but I make it a goal of mine to say every day I want to live today for eternity. Because I know if I live today for eternity, the older I get and the closer I get there, the less regret I'm going to have and the more gratitude I'm going to have. And when I start looking back, did my life mean anything? Then I'm going to be able to live not for myself, but to make an impact in the lives of others. How do you judge that? I don't know. At what age do you judge what kind of impact a person's had on others? How long after they're dead, 10 years, 50 years, 100 years? Or will only that day really be able to judge and determine and measure what kind of impact your life made for the kingdom of God? So, I want to do what I've done every week for the last 3 weeks. I want to give you 2 points and a prayer. Come on, look at somebody. Say 2 points and a prayer. Come on, tell them. 2 points and a prayer. Here's how you and I can live today without worry about tomorrow, but living for tomorrow. And the first one is that we will live today to leave a legacy. We are going to, say that out loud with me. We are going to leave a legacy. We're going to live today to leave a legacy. In other words, when it comes to our money, when it comes to our finances. See, the Bible says this, the wisest man other than Jesus to ever live was King Solomon. And he wrote this in Proverbs chapter 21. He said, the wise man saves for the future, but the foolish man spends whatever he gets. In other words, no thought of tomorrow. I got it today. I'm going to enjoy it today. I'm going to live it up today. I'm going to have the best today. And then he finds out tomorrow he's not prepared. There's no real legacy. Nothing to leave. In fact, I told you a couple of weeks ago when we talked about debt that the Bible says in the book of Proverbs 22 verse 7 that the rich rule over the poor and the borrower is a servant or a slave to the lender. Right? Do you know what the verse right before that verse, Proverbs 22 verse 6 is? Listen to this. Proverbs 22 verse 6 says, train up a child in the way he shall go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. What do you want me to train him? That the rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender. See, me and my wife, I told you on our first installment of this series, we had to pay for our own wedding because neither one of our parents were financially able to provide us a wedding. We had great parents, but they didn't know anything about money. They didn't handle money properly. They didn't have any money. They left no money. And me and my wife started out living the only way we knew, living like our parents lived. And we were living the American nightmare, a house payment, a car payment, and 4 credit cards. Come on, everybody. But in my early 30s, and I tell this if you want to go back and listen to the first message, we began to understand, man, this is just going to keep going like this. And God began to speak to our hearts. And hey, in those days, everybody, we didn't have Dave Ramsey. Come on. And so we had to just get in the Word of God and get counsel and humble ourselves. And we began to cut back and clear out. And we began to say, no, not yet. And we began to get out of debt. And we made sure we gave God the best and the first. Come on, everybody. And then we became generous with what God was blessed. And it took us about 3.5 years, but God helped us get out of debt. And then we were able to invest in the kingdom of God like we never knew we were able to. We were able to invest in the lives of our children, give them opportunities me and my wife never had. But let me tell you what we did that we didn't know we were doing at the time. We were teaching our kids how to live like our parents had not taught us. Now listen to me. Oh, we used to put 4 cups on their dresser. One of them, every time we gave money, one of them said tithe. They had to put their tithe in that white styrofoam cup. The next one said savings. They had to tithe 10%, save 10%. And then the next one said savings 4. In other words, if they wanted something but didn't have enough money, they didn't put it on a credit card. They had to wait until they could save enough from each week. Come on, till they had enough. Come on. And then we had spending, and they could spend whatever they wanted to. What we didn't realize is we were giving them a legacy. Today, my daughter's 32. My son is 38, married with 2 grandkids. And both of them have learned to live debt-free lifestyles. Both of them have no credit card debt hanging over their head. Come on, everybody. They don't have the proverbial American nightmare like we did. In fact, my kids have savings and retirement, and they're generous, and they're tithers. And both of them have told me and my wife, hey, Dad, Mom, do whatever you want to with your money. We don't need your money. In fact, both my kids are better off in their 30s now than I am in my 60s. Come on, somebody. Who would not want that for their family? So God is challenging you today to start today, no matter where you are, no matter where you are, no matter how old you are. And I know what you may be thinking, but nobody taught me. Man, I'm in a mess. Yeah, but you can start today. You can't go back and change your start, but you can start today and change your end. And not just your end, but for generations to come. This is what's fabulous about it. In fact, I told the first service, there was a man came to our church several years ago. He was 65 years old. He was disabled. He was retired from working in prisons and Homeland Security. And he, before he was 35, he had been married and divorced 5 times and had not been married the last 30 years. And he gave his heart to Christ, and he started learning the Word of God and learning about giving God his first and his best. And then we have a class just like you have here, Financial Peace University. And he went through that class, and he began to seek God. God, give me self-control. God, give me a plan. And Financial Peace helped him come up with this plan. And over the next 5 years, by the time he was 70, he had reconnected with his only daughter that was estranged and was now married. He restored that relationship. And actually, God used him to lead her and her husband to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ in their life. Come on, everybody. And in the church were a group of veterans. And this man was a veteran, and my family worked with him. And he found out he had never used veteran benefits, and he found out he could get a VA loan and buy his very first home at 70 years old. 70 years old. And when he bought that home, he bought insurance that when he couldn't pay for that home anymore, that home would be paid for. And 6 years later, at 76 years old, he died, went to heaven to be with the Lord, and left his daughter an inheritance and a legacy even after living the first 65 years of his life without God. See, the Bible says this in Isaiah chapter 48. I want you to grab hold of this. It's powerful. Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer. See, God can redeem your past. He can redeem the days you've lost. He can restore them if you humble yourself. And if you'll start living today to leave a legacy. The Holy One of Israel, I'm the Lord your God who teaches you to profit, who leads you in the way that you should go. I believe God's led you to Dream City Church. I believe God's led you here today. And let me tell you something. What's so great about Dream City Church is you've got great lead pastors. Come on, everybody. Who loves you. Who lives the way we're talking about as an example before you. And who a couple of years ago with a couple here from the church, the McNutts, they decided that they were going to offer to you Financial Peace University. You may be saying, I don't know anything about investing and insurance and saving. And I don't know how. All I know is what my parents and my grandparents did, or I've tried to do what they didn't do, but I'm in a mess. That's why you can get involved in Financial Peace. It's a 9-week small group, really, is what it is. And in 9 weeks, they can teach you the principles of God's Word. They can teach you about insurance and investing and saving and how to get out of debt and how to begin to leave a legacy with the finances that God has blessed you with. And in 9 weeks' time, oh, you won't be there, but you'll at least have a plan, and you'll have heard from God, and you will be on your way to not only changing your future, but the future of the generations of your future. Now listen to me. Listen to me. When this service is over, there's a table out in the Great Hall, Financial Peace University. They're going to be starting in a few weeks. Why not sign up? Why not go ahead and make up your mind? Remember, we're going to live today to leave a legacy. We're not going to worry about tomorrow. No, we're going to be faithful today so that we're prepared for tomorrow. Now, here's the second thing we're going to do. We are going to give today to impact eternity. Now, everybody look at me. I could feel it right then. I'm not fixing to take an offering. Come on, look at somebody, smile. Get that church look off your face. Smile at somebody and say, he's not going to take an offering. We're going to live every day to leave a legacy, and we're going to give every day of our lives to impact eternity. See, God was speaking through this Apostle Paul again to another young pastor. And he was teaching this pastor, you need to teach your congregation. Look what he said, 1 Timothy chapter number 6. It's beautiful. Verse number 18. Tell them to use their money to do good. They should be rich in good works and generous to those in need, always being ready to share with others. Watch this, the words of Jesus again. By doing this, they will be storing up their treasures as a good foundation for the future, so that they may experience true life. True life. Let me just help you. You know the chair you're sitting in right now? Come on, everybody just look down, grab it right quick. Come on, grab that chair you're sitting in. Long before you ever got, most of you have come in the last 6 years. Long before you ever sat in that chair, somebody else lived by this principle. They built this building. They bought those chairs. They created children's environments so that your children could hear, not play games, but hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. You tripped yourself over, you stepped over all the rumors and all the craziness, and you came. And I don't know at which point, but something grabbed you, and in some moment you decided to give your life to Christ and to make this church your home. And today you are a Bible toting, scripture toting child of the living God. And maybe the people that did that are already in heaven. But because they did it then, you have been impacted for eternity now. Now here's what I want you to understand. When it comes to giving God our first and our best and then living generous with the rest, let me tell you something. They're coming. They're coming. A young person in their 20s or 30s that the world has let them down, and their parties let them down, and the answers were not true, and they're confused and they don't know what to do, and they're looking for answers, and they're going to walk in here. And there's a woman somewhere that's been praying for her alcoholic husband, and she's been believing God to just save him, to just get him in an environment, and she's looked for places, and she's going to walk in here one day believing that this is the place and that one day he'll walk in here. There's a single mother that's trying to raise her children, and she it isn't that she's lived wrong, but she got abandoned, and now she's financially strapped and she's stressed, but she wants to give her children a future. She wants to connect them to God, and she's going to walk in here one day. And there's a man who's raising his children. His wife left him. She walked out, confused, on drugs, deceived, but he hadn't given up yet. And he needs somebody to believe with him. He needs somebody to believe that God can bring her back home, that God can deliver her, that God can bring a mama back to those children. And just like you did one day, they're going to walk in this building. What if it was your son, your daughter, your wife, your husband? Wouldn't you want there to be a place like Dream City Church? The only way it'll happen is if you start giving today to impact eternity. There's a verse of scripture in Psalms chapter 22. And I'm going to wind it down. Here we go. Everybody say, he's in his initial descent. Not my final descent, my initial descent, okay? All who prosper on earth will eat and bow down. All those who go down to the dust will kneel before him.
We're going to all die one day. You're dying. You're going to die. I'm sorry. You're going to die one day. Hope it's a long time, but you're going to die one day unless Jesus comes. Even the one who cannot preserve his life, nothing we can do to stop it. But their descendants will serve him. And the next generation after their descendants will be told about the Lord. And they will come and tell a people yet to be born about his righteousness and what he has done. In other words, God is saying, you can leave a legacy and make an eternal impact. Not just while you're alive, but even after you're gone. For the next generation that's walking through the doors. And then that generation, because of what you did, will be able to invest in the next generation. And then that generation will be able to invest in a generation that hadn't even been thought about or been born yet. So that one day in eternity, you will meet the people that you invested now in because of your investment. They made it to heaven. Generation after generation. That's why there's schools in Burundi with a tribe that never had their own school. That was an oppressed tribe in Burundi. But Dream City Church built the very first school and the second school and a dormitory. And it's not just to educate their mind, but it's to tell them about Jesus Christ. And long after you're gone, those schools will still be reaching children in Burundi for the Lord Jesus Christ. And community of hope that's giving mothers a hand up and children, giving children an opportunity to see the love of God displayed. So, what really matters? We're going to live today to leave a legacy. We're going to give today to impact eternity. Here's the prayer. All three prayers have been this. God, give me self-control. We prayed that. I hope you're still praying it. God, give me a plan. He'll answer that if you'll go out to financial peace table right after this. I'm telling you, he'll give you a plan. Number three, God, give me the courage to obey. That's where you are right now. But here's the prayer I want us to pray today. This one is not a God, give me prayer. This prayer is, and it's God, I give up my own way. And I give myself to you. See, Jesus said it like this in Luke 9:23. He said to the crowd, he said to us, we're the crowd this morning. If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way. Take up your cross. Say it out loud with me. Daily. Daily means today. When you go to bed tonight and get up in the morning on Monday morning, it'll be day. Daily. And when you go to bed Monday night and get up on Tuesday, one day at a time, live for today. Live today faithfully. Living to leave a legacy, giving to impact eternity. And I promise you this, if you will do this one day at a time, you're going to begin to live with a satisfaction inside of you, a contentment inside of you. And the older you get, and the closer you get to eternity, you're going to live with purpose, knowing that your life was lived for something that really mattered. And when you step on the other side and you stand before Jesus, your works won't burn, but your building will stand strong. I challenge you today. Don't wait. Don't put it off. Don't say tomorrow. No, today. Live the rest of your life in pursuit. Pleasing God, living for others, not yourself, and live for what really matters. Head bowed, eye closed all over this room. I want to pray for families, for couples, for young people, for senior citizens. And for those of you here today that may not have a personal relationship with God, this is your moment. And it begins with the same prayer. It just begins by saying, God, I give up my own way, and I give myself to your way and to your purposes and to you. And I tell you, with this simple prayer, the presence of God and the power of his Spirit will invade your life. And day by day, your life will become a life of meaning and of purpose. Live for eternity. Father, from the left to the right, from the front to the back, I pray for men and women, people who are saying yes to Jesus right now. Men and women who are, even though they knew you today, they are surrendering their life. No longer to live for themselves, but to live for eternity. I ask you to bless them, favor them, empower them, and encourage them. And use them for your glory. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, can we give the Lord a great big praise? Can we do that? Can we? Hey, Dream City, stand up with me just before you leave. Hey, don't forget safe families. I tell you, just stop by there. You never know how God will touch your heart so that you can live to impact the lives of others. I love you. Thank you for this last month. I'll see you soon. Be back next Sunday. Pastors Mark and Eric will be here. You're dismissed.